breath till that stone was moved for good. For the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who.
Okay, now a couple of things that are happening today. There's going to be, we've got a guest speaker here from the Bible League. His name is Nick. Welcome, Nick. Give him a hand, shall we? Okay, he's going to share something now about the Bible League, and then I'll share something after that. Come on up here, Nick.
Well, good morning, wonderful folk. Thanks very much for actually welcoming me back. I presented Bible League here, or at the previous place some years ago. So it's nice to be able to reconnect with some of you. So thank you for that. Okay, let's pray this works. So you know, Jesus said, "Go," or actually, in the Greek, it's "as you are going." Don't wait till you get to point B, might be Africa. But if you're called to Africa, don't wait till you get to Africa to preach the gospel. It's as you're on that journey, getting there as well. And so go into all the world, preach the gospel and make disciples of all nations. And the imperative there, the command is to preach the gospel and make disciples of all nations. So Bible League are currently in just over 50-odd nations. Helping to prepare the world for the return of the Lord. I thought I heard a trumpet sound in here earlier this morning and I was getting excited, but I'm still here. And I'd like to encourage people as a first thing when I present, because the Bible says, encourage one another in your blessed hope. And I would like to encourage you, Jesus Christ is returning. He's coming back. He's coming back for you. And he's coming back for the people that the Lord will transform through you as well. So please smile this morning. There's a crown waiting for those who eagerly await his return. And I want to make sure that's one of the crowns that I'm able to cast before the Lord. before I begin, one of the testimonies that came out of COVID actually. You know, Jesus said to the Philadelphia church, I place before you an open door that no man can close. Philadelphia, philia, meaning love, so it's the church of love. And the open door, I believe, is a portion to the mission field. But one of the areas that came out, or one of the things that came out of COVID when the enemy thought he could shut the world down, was in Zimbabwe, which is where we are, we travel into the very rural areas. And the government said, well, look, you know where to track do you mind if we send our government medical staff with you so that they can bring education to the rural areas? And so we agreed with that. Now, our target was to reach 26,000 people. But because we were able to use the resources of the government, we were able to reach up to 200,000 people. So, you know, here was the enemy trying to close down the mission field. But Jesus said, no, I've placed before you an open door that no man can close. And that's a word for everybody here this morning. And who knows what else is on the horizon, but to the Philadelphia church, whatever else is on the horizon, there is an open door that we will walk through and can walk through. And oh, sorry, we also were able to preach the gospel to the medical staff as well. So there was that as well. So here we have, you know, Jeremiah 15:16. Okay, I found thy word and I did eat it, and it became a rejoicing unto the very core of who I am. And I'd like, if I may, to connect that with Romans 12, verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present yourselves as a living sacrifice, for this is your reasonable service, holy and acceptable unto the Lord, of course. But how do I connect this scripture behind me and Romans 12, verse 1? Has anybody here been involved in livestock farming? Maybe a couple. The type of animal that was used, or some of the types of animals that were used as a sacrifice in the Old Testament, was called a clean animal, like a sheep or a goat, cow. And how did they survive as a sacrifice? Now, you and I are a sacrifice, but we're a living sacrifice. But the way God designed the animal in the Old Testament that was a clean animal, it would eat and swallow and digest. But then it did something else. It would regurgitate what it ate and then chew back on what they ate. So they would chew the cud, or they would, I won't use another word there, just for the sake of discretion. But they would swallow, digest, bring it back up, chew on that again, then digest it. And that was the process that God had engineered that type of sacrifice with which to survive. But you and I are a living sacrifice. And we have a different form of food, don't we? What's that food? We find God's word and we do eat it. And it becomes a rejoicing unto our soul, unto the very core, unto our heart, very core of who we are. So Bible League's desire is to get this process occurring into the regions around the world that are under-resourced and persecuted. The entrance of his word, it gives light, it gives understanding, in fact, to the depths of the simple. So can I suggest that it's only God's word that will do this? When we need light, we cannot go to any other form of book unless the Bible is in that book. I don't want to downplay if anybody here has written a book and what have you. I'm not here to judge that by any means. But what will bring light is a book that has the word of God in it, and only the word of God. So this is what Martin Luther said, wasn't it? He said, the Bible is alive, it speaks to me. It has feet, it runs after me. It has hands, and it lays a hold of me. In fact, just to reiterate that point, I've just got another slide there. You know, when you read scripture, you are relationshiping or beginning to relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. In Psalms it says, in the volume of the book it is written of me. In Hebrews it says, in the volume of the book it is written of me. So of whom is that? Jesus Christ. And I love that because, you know, Jesus said this when he quoted scripture at the enemy, at the devil, when he just began his ministry. He didn't just quote scripture. What did he say? It is written. So he's placing importance not only on the word, but on the fact that it has been written. It is written, and then he quotes the scripture. So our heart is to get what is written into the nations. And just to share in the volume of the book, just one example in the book of Genesis, where you have the first 10 generational names from Adam to Noah. You may have heard this, but it's worth sharing just to show how Jesus Christ can be taught from the Old Testament. So in the Hebrew, I'll go through the first 10 generational names. So you've got Adam, which means man, Seth means appointed, Enosh means mortal, Cana means sorrow, Mahalalel means the blessed God, Jared means shall come down, Enoch means teaching, Methuselah means his death shall bring, Lamech means the despairing, and Noah means comfort or rest. So if you put that together in a sentence, you have man is appointed mortal sorrow, but the everlasting God shall come down teaching that his death shall bring the despairing rest. So there you have the gospel of Jesus Christ in the meaning of the first 10 generational names from Adam to Noah. So we have an amazing book, but 10 million people in Ghana, they want, or probably about 9.5 million now in Ghana, want a Bible. They don't have one. 95% of Christians in Mozambique, although there are Bibles there, but not so much in the rural areas, they want a Bible. They don't have one. So our heart is to get into those regions with the Word of God. And again, just to reiterate the point, Lord, speak to me. I want to hear your voice. I'm not saying that outside the council of many, you can't hear Word of God. Of course, also, there are many avenues with which God speaks to us through our leaders, through council, through each other, but certainly through the Word of God as well. So if you were to ask, what is Bible League's strategy? It's discipleship. Generally, we won't give a Bible unless people agree to be discipled. That way, we know that we're planting the Word of God and it remains as a seed. And it's planted in good soil because the Word of God actually transforms us as we digest it and begin to understand it and study it. There's a little word at the end of Psalms or some of the chapters. Do you know what that word is? Selah. What does it mean? Pause, digest it, chew on it, regurgitate it, and mull on it. So that's what our heart is to bring instruction to the Word of God. Our purpose, really, we serve the under-resourced church and the persecuted church by providing Bibles, scripture materials, and training also for the sole purpose of bringing people to Jesus Christ. Our heart is the eternal state of the human soul. You know, you can, and there's nothing wrong with it, but we need to be balanced in terms of giving to humanitarian aid and giving the Word of God. You know, you can rearrange the deck chairs on the Titanic and make people feel comfortable. But if all you do is rearrange the deck chairs on the Titanic, it's going to sink. And everybody on board that ship, even though they feel comfortable as it's sinking, it's still going to sink. But if you bring people off that ship and put them on the good ship Lollipop, it's going to bring them salvation in a sense. So our heart is to bring people the Word of God with training so that there's an eternal consequence to that. One of our focuses is the persecuted church. I'm not sure if you're aware, but if you were to put a definition on what's happening regarding the persecuted church, it would come close to genocide. So 380 million Christians globally live in persecution, at least. And certainly in the last couple of years, that's increased. One of our endeavours is the Ukraine. My wife is from Siberia. And so whatever you do, don't mention the war. But Bible League's got nothing to do with politics in this sense. We're simply getting God's word to regions around the Ukraine where there are refugees passing through the borders. So we're working in places like Poland, Romania, Moldova. And our aim is to get 40,000 Bibles a month at least to those refugees that are desperately needing the word of God. How are we fulfilling our purpose? Everything that Bible League provides, there's no cost to the recipient. So we do rely on the Christian community, our brothers and sisters in these resource nations to help get his word into the under-resourced. As briefly mentioned, discipleship, we've just simply called it Project Philip. Philip the evangelist met the Ethiopian. He was reading the scroll of Isaiah and he didn't understand it. And so Philip asked, "Do you understand?" And the reply was, "Well, how can I? Unless somebody comes alongside me and brings instruction." So we've just called our discipleship material Project Philip. And Bible-based literacy. So no point giving a Bible unless people agree to be, unless people read, can read. So we're teaching both adults and children to read using biblical precepts and concepts. And church planting. So since we began in 1938, we've helped to plant over 75,000 churches in 60-odd nations. So how can we be involved? Please pray for us, just as I close this morning. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. That's the bottom line. There are powers and principalities, I guess in the second heaven there, that try to wreak havoc on the body of Christ and prevent the word of God. And so prayer is one of those avenues in which the Lord can use to step in and bring a blocking force to our blocking force. God's not waiting reluctantly to hear your prayers so that he can hesitantly answer them. God is waiting in complete anticipation to hear your prayers so that he can lovingly and lavish an answer upon your prayer. So just as I close, if you would like to contribute in any way, it's a coffee and a donut, or two coffees and two donuts, or if you don't drink coffee, a tea and a piece of carrot cake, I guess, per fortnight, in a sense, is all it takes for us to get God's word into the nation. So $20 will get up to two Bibles. One Bible transforms a family of five, and that family inevitably a culture. So thank you very much. This gentleman and this lady thank the Christian community, such as yourself, for helping them receive his word. So the Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, the Lord make his face to shine upon you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Pastor John.
Yeah, just over there behind William. He's not guarding the table, it's just where it is. Wonderful. It's amazing what the Word of God can do. I want to share a quick story because young man came in here on Thursday asking questions. He just rang me and said, I don't know about this spiritual stuff. And he came in, he rang me up, and I said, I wasn't supposed to be here. And so I invited him down, and I spent an hour with him. And I just want to encourage you, because you have a few grandparents here. The reason he has come, his parents don't have anything to do with church. But his grandfather did. And he started looking at some of his grandfather's material. And he became curious. And so he arrives here and he's already got his Bible in his hand. He doesn't know anything much. And just like, he was just ready to give his life to Jesus. And that's happening here in Burpengary. Now, I was hoping he'd be here today, so you keep praying for him. Because, you see, if his family aren't for him or for connecting to a church, you know there's going to be some opposition. So you just pray for these people that what's been sown, because he's got a Bible, he's got two Bibles now, he's got some literature, and he's got the offer of going through next steps. So just be encouraged about that. That's just random, let alone the ones that you are ministering to. Thank you, Nick, for that. That was really good. And as I say, check the table out. I've got here a tape. It's a form of duct tape. Duct tape is very useful. But you've got to know what you're going to use it for. Out of all the uses that it has, maybe you may not, like this young man did from Alaska, when he decided he wanted to get across to an island, built a boat. And the way he built the boat, he just had the frame and he used duct tape. And he just duct taped it around and around and around. And he decided, well, he thought that he was putting his trust in this. And him and his dog hopped into the boat and they began to make their way across the channel to the island. It was a fine day. There wasn't wind or anything. But halfway across, his boat began to sink. And so the lifeguard had to come and rescue him. And you say, Pastor John, what are you telling that story for? Well, the moral of the story is duct tape is very good for many things. But you've got to know whether your duct tape is going to get you across to the other side or not. So here's the question. Do you know what's going to get you across to the other side? And we're wrapping up 1 John this morning. And John gives us, in just a few verses, some key things. Because in these verses, he says, know, K-N-O-W, five times. That you might know. That you might know. That you might know how you're going to get to the other side. So we're going to have a quick look at that this morning. And you're going to have to take notes because it's going to be a quick message. This word know, I checked it out. I thought I'm going to be good. I'm going to check out the Greek. I'm going to check out there to see if there's any deeper meaning in this word know. And I've come to the conclusion that know means no. It's just the context. You can have a knowing relating to understanding, or you can have a knowing in the sense of where you know a person or you are intimate with that person or something like that. It just depends on the context. But no means no. So let's think about this for a moment. Let's look at these statements that John makes as he wraps up the message of 1 John. The first thing is this. In verse 13, he says this, "I have written this to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know you have eternal life." Notice the context. Every time you look at these things, look at the context, as that gives you the prime meaning of something. So that you may know that you have eternal life. The context is this: it's those who believe in will know. The believing in somebody is something different to believing about someone. If I just believe about someone, it's not the same as if I've met him, I'm relating to him, I'm really connecting with him. That's when I begin to know him or believe in him. And so the context is for those who believe in. So today, if you believe in the name of the Son of God, if you believe in Jesus, you've given your life over to him, then you are born again of the Spirit of God. And the promise to you is from the Word of God that you can know that you have eternal life. That has started. Spiritually, we were dead before we gave our life to Christ. Now we are spiritually alive, and that eternal life is going on forever. My body might disintegrate, but my soul and my spirit won't. And then there's the resurrection, and my body comes back again, all incorruptible. That's pretty cool. We've only just got number one. Let's go on. Then he talks about confidence, and he says in verse 14, "And we are confident that he hears us whenever we ask for anything that pleases him." Notice the context again. We have what we ask for if we're asking for things that please him. Or in some of your translations, it may have it this way: in line with his will. So when we ask things that we know is in line with God's will, we know that we have the answer. And we might say, well, what does that really look like? Well, I think Jesus, look at Jesus. He's on the way to the cross. He knows where he has to go. But before he got captured by the Romans, where was he? He was in Gethsemane. And while he's in Gethsemane, the magnitude of what he was going to go through began to hit him in all his humanity. I mean, he's the God-man. He still feels. And he begins to understand what he's going to go through, that this is a cruel death that's coming. And he's praying to his Father, and as he kneels and he prays to his Father, he says, "If you can take this cup from me, that'd be really cool." That's just a paraphrase, just in case you know. "That'd be really cool. But your will be done." And sometimes that attitude is not something that rises to the surface amongst us. But what's God's will in this? When we're praying for that change of a job or that promotion, when we're praying for those kind of things to happen, it may be that the Lord wants you still there, or it may be he's got something in mind for you. But do we sort of say, well, Lord, your will. I'm going to pray about this, but your will be done, because you've got a bigger picture. The psalmist says in Psalm 37, verse 4, "Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you your heart's desires." Notice what it's saying. You get your heart's desires as you delight in the Lord. If you're not delighting in the Lord, okay, then many times my desires aren't in line with his will. But I find that as I delight in the Lord, okay, my will seems to come in line with what his will is. And even if his will is that I'm going through a bit of toughness for a while, guess what? There's something's changed. I know I'm in his will, you see, and I can move through. So verse 15 of John says this, so since we know that he hears us when we make our requests, we also know that he will give us what we ask for. No. Since we know that he hears us, do you know that your prayers are not just here? Your prayers go to the very throne room of grace. Your prayers are not bouncing off the ceiling, church. Sometimes you may wonder, you say, well, I'm not quite getting the answer that I want. Well, maybe the answer that you want is not in his will just yet. Maybe there's something we have to learn, something that you have to do, whatever it may be. But the Word of God says we know that he hears. And if we know that he hears, then we know that the answer's on the way, whatever that answer may be. You're okay? Righto. Just checking. All right. So what are these other ones? So let's move on. So he goes on and he says this. Now understand, before I start reading this, remember this is in the context of praying. There's a particular context in the where this word comes out. So it says this. So if you see a fellow believer sinning in a way that does not lead to death, you should pray. And God will give that person life. But there is a sin that leads to death. And I'm not saying that you should pray for those who commit it. All wicked actions are sin, but not every sin leads to death. Oh, that's a bit, oh, I don't know. But there's promise in there. See, what the Word of God is saying, remember the context. Remember the context. First of all, it's talking about fellow believers. We're not talking about people who no longer know the Lord or never known the Lord or anything like that. Talking about somebody that's walked with the Lord and you're starting to see that they're getting caught up in stuff. You see, this early church, they had a lot of people leave. They had the people leave because people began to doubt that Jesus actually came in the flesh. They began to doubt, oh no, maybe they thought, and I don't know this for sure, but this is just speculation, okay? Maybe they thought, oh, you couldn't have God the Father really allow his son to physically die and go through all of that. And they began to speculate, and so they ended up saying, oh no, Jesus was just a spirit. He wasn't here in the flesh. And of course, the problem with that is that if he is just a spirit, how does he relate to you and me when I've got flesh and bone and I'm living here in the real world? So John speaks against that. And some people started going down that track. And then these people that started leading some astray, they seemed to have this focus on the spiritual stuff. Oh, we've got this inner knowledge and this inner revelation. And maybe they were great speakers. And so people were getting swayed. So in this context, John says, if you see somebody, this is your fellow brother, your fellow sister, beginning to walk away, to kind of get sucked in, you should pray for him. You should pray for him. Go into the throne room. Bring your prayers and your requests to the throne room that they might be able to see what's going on. And, of course, we can do that today as well. You may not have someone going down that track, but as we mentioned a few weeks ago, sometimes people just get caught up in the world. And so they've started to follow Jesus and now this issue has come up and that issue has come up and doubts have begun to sink into them and they're battling. You see someone like that, you don't judge them. You pray for them. You pray that God will speak to their heart, refresh their heart, so that they can come back into that place with Him. So we pray for people in that way. But He also mentions some people that are going down a particular track, and I call these people, they're ones that have become anti-Christ altogether. They have become anti the Holy Spirit. They've turned so far away from that that that's where they are. Remember, he talked about anti-Christ spirit early on in the thing. That's where, and he's saying, and now he's not telling you not to pray for them. He's saying you don't have to have the emphasis on them. Pray for those that, you know, that they haven't become anti-Christ. Pray for them. But if they become anti-Christ, just give them over to the Lord. Give them over to the Lord. Let him begin to do them. Because you know what? Our Lord that we serve always works behind the scenes seeking to bring people to himself. Is everybody okay? All right. Coming down. Look at what he says here. And we know that God's children do not make a practice of sinning. For God's Son holds them securely, and the evil one cannot touch them. We know that we are children of God, and that the world around us is under the control of the evil one. Okay. If you're born of the Spirit of God, John is saying to us, you don't practice sin. What do you mean, Pastor? You're saying, I've got to be sinless. That's not what it's saying. It says you don't practice it. If you were, when you were living in the world, you just did whatever. Now you've been born again of the Spirit of God, what you'll find begins to happen is this. There are some things that need to be sorted out in my life and in your life. And the Holy Spirit is there giving us the checks. And we have the Word of God that helps to keep us on track. But if I go down life and I begin to ignore the checks and begin to ignore the Word of God, and I'm pushing against it, I'm actually practicing disobedience. You see, when you're practicing something, you go over it and over it and over it till you fine-tune it, don't you? The Word of God says, you know, if you're born again of the Spirit of God, you're not going to practice sin. That means you're not going to keep doing it. When the check comes, when the conviction comes, you're going to confess it before the Lord, get yourself cleaned up so you can move forward again. You're not going to just keep on doing it and keep on doing it and keep on doing it. And so this is what he says. The other thing I notice, though, he talks about, he says, but you're being held, the Son of God, God's the Son, is holding you. He's holding you. See, the enemy of your souls can come at you again and again, and he'll try to trip you up, and he'll try to use your weakness, he'll try to do all of those sort of things. But the Word of God tells me that Jesus holds me. It may be coming, but Jesus holds me. The pressure may be on, but Jesus holds me. So have you got that sense he's holding you? The enemy's out there, but don't go focusing so much on the enemy that you forget that Jesus will hold you. As you press into him, you keep your eyes on him. He's the one that holds you. I think that's worth an amen from someone. Do you get it? Good on you, little rain. He holds you. And then he goes on and he says, and we know that we are the children of God. Do you know it? Here's the last no. I said it's going to be short. In verse 20, it says this, And we know. What do we know? We know that the Son of God has come. Do you know it? Or is there doubts in the mix? Oh, you hear this over here and you hear this over here. You go onto the internet and some people are starting to say this, that and the other. Do you know that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, has come and that he is the Son of God? You see. Is it so deep inside of you that as soon as someone begins to doubt it, you've got some argument that you can put to them and say, well, hey, listen, how can you say he's a myth? How can you say he's a myth when there's more evidence for Jesus not only existing, not only being someone who did by secular and other writers, someone who did magic arts, someone who did miracles. And not only that he existed, but that he was put to death by the Romans. There's more evidence for that. And there's more evidence for his resurrection than for many historical figures of that age. Throw it back. Do you know? It's not just a matter of stepping in faith. Your faith is built on something that is a strong foundation. It's not just hairy-fairy. It's something that's built on something that's a good foundation. And he says this, the Son of God has come and he has given us understanding. So what Jesus did was that he revealed what God was really like. What God the Father was really like. Down where I could see him. Down where I could see like flesh and bone as it were. He walked amongst people like you and me. He dealt with all kinds of situations. He dealt with temptations like you and I. And he dealt with it all righteously and in the correct way. That one, that Jesus, he's given us understanding so that we can know the true God. And now, he says, we live in fellowship with the true God because we live in fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ. And in case anyone doesn't get it, the Word of God says, he is the true God. He is eternal life. So what do you know? As we wrap up that whole segment, what do you know about Jesus? He is eternal life. He is the Son of God. You can have complete confidence. You can know that your prayers are being heard. Your prayers are being answered. You know that you're praying in his will. If you're praying in the way that he pleases him, you know the answer is on the way. Marie, could you just come and just do your thing? That thing that she does, she just brings in. Let's just center on the Lord for a little bit. Church, in a world that doesn't have hope, a world that doesn't have the answers, we need to be strong and secure inside. So that we know, no shadow of doubt, no questioning, I know who he is, I know he hears me, I know who I belong to. The devil can come at me, he can come at you, but I know there's someone that holds me in his hand. And he's not going to let me go. He's not going to let you go. Father, just pray that the word that has been given, that you would just, Lord, you will cement your truth into our hearts. I pray, Lord, that as that word goes out, it'll build faith in each one of us. That faith will continue to stand strong, not just in the midst of everyday life, but in the midst of pressure. When people may come at us and say, you know, you're just believing a whole lot of myths. Lord, that we will know, not only by experience, but by the Word of God, but also by the facts of history. Just pray now, Lord, that you will cement that in each one's heart. In Jesus' name.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. All the earth rejoices. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. How great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hand.
Sing with me.